Please start.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Tejaswini here, presenting a case. Here is a patient, Mr. XX, aged 78-year-old, working as daily wage laborer, hailing from Ganj Circle, Raichur, with no formal education, belongs to lower middle class of Kuppuswamy classification. His chief complaints are pain in the left foot since 4 months and blackish discoloration of left foot since 3 months. History of present illness as follows. Patient was apparently well 4 months back when he started feeling pain in the left foot on walking, which is continuous, severe, localized to left foot, aching in nature. Pain aggravates on lying down and is relieved by hanging his leg by the side of foot. By the side of bed, and there is no diurnal variation. History of intermittent claudication present with claudication distance of 500 meters, increased to become rest pain within a month. History of blackish discoloration of left first toe noticed 3 months back, which was insidious in onset, associated with increased sensation. With no history of trauma to the foot, he underwent amputation of toe at the local hospital. History of blackish discoloration of remaining toes of left foot for 1 month. The blackish discoloration progressed to involve the whole of the left foot and lower part of the left leg in the last 1 month. It is associated with loss of sensation of left foot with no history of trauma to the foot. The dried black area over the dorsum and lateral part of the ankle sloughed off and he developed ulceration 1 week back. It developed spontaneously, painful, hypersensitive with no discharge. And he is known case of diabetic mellitus type 2 since 7 years and was on oral hypoglycemic agent for 7 years and on insulin for the last 1 month. He is a known case of hypertension on medication since 4 years. He is a known case of smoker, smokes 4 to 5 cigarettes per day for the last 20 years. And there is no history of claudication pain in the left thigh and right lower limb and both upper limbs. No history of fainting, transient blackouts. No history of chest pain, abdominal pain, GI symptoms, blurring of vision, oliguria, weakness or paresthesia in the upper limb, fever and superficial thrombophlebitis. Past history, not a known case of tuberculosis, asthma.
Tejaswini.
Yes, sir.
Can you go to the first slide, please? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
First slide, yeah. So you have to hide the name for the simple reason that it should not become a legal issue or ethical issue. That is,
yes, fine.
You said 78 or 48?
48 years old, sir.
Sorry?
48 years old, sir.
So you have a patient who is, this is your first interaction with the patient. You say, how old are you? Say,
yes,
40, 48. So when he says 48, in relation to the peripheral arterial disease,
yes,
what are the things come into your mind now? Tell me first. Only based,
sir,
on the age.
Sir, based on the age, mainly I think of two diseases, Burgers and atherosclerosis, sir.
So you would like to consider the disease of Burgess disease and atherosclerosis.
Yes,
if
sir.
I ask you a further question, probably which one it is likely? Which one? Between
Sir, we normally say Burgess is less than 40 years of old. And so I do think of atherosclerosis, sir.
Okay, all right. So this is a little of a doubtful or what we call as between 40 and 50. So when you have a patient of 48, with this kind of a picture of a, you have written there, no formal education, lower middle class, obviously,
yes,
a smoker, if it's there, it's,
yes,
probably would like to consider a thromboangitis obliterans at this stage. That,
yes,
is,
sir,
what you should try to think. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I said between this 40 and 50 is a bit of a gray zone. That's all right.
Yes. Yes,
now,
sir,
you have written there other things, religion is really not really required. Unless there are specific diseases confined to certain diseases. For example, you know, circumcision, which is not done in certain communities. Circumcision,
yes,
is done. So carcinoma penis is more common in. So in this, you it is not really necessary to bring that. Okay, all yes, right. Take yes, away sir. Laborers and lower middle class. Why do you want to highlight here,
sir? This lower middle class family, they are more prone for thrombangitis obliterans, sir. Smoking history and all. So and even they will walk with barefoot, so there is higher chance of infection. And so the patient is
yes, that is why I said in the beginning, when you have a 48-year-old male,
yes sir,
who is coming from the lower socioeconomic background, yes, daily sir. Wage labor by occupation,
yes
so
sir,
will go for a poor man's disease. Poor man's disease is popularly is a Burgess disease.
Yes okay. sir. Yes.
On the other end, if he's atherosclerotic, etc.,
rich man's disease.
Yes, yeah, so something like that. Not yes, necessarily sir. Everyone is a rich person in that, but this is how we generally analyze it. Okay.
Yes, yes sir.
Go to the next.
Sir, pain in the left foot since 4 months and blackish discoloration of left foot since 3 months. Sir.
So now, what do you think this pain?
Sir, he has pain in the foot. So, the pain may be due to either a diabetic neuropathy or claudication pain.
So, now it's important at this stage. So, it will show you in the next slide. Just open the next slide.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, now here, you have written now some of the important features of claudication and all you have written there. Yes, now, sir. Tell me, how do you say it's related to vascular pathology? By your, whatever you have written there.
Yes, sir. Sir, the patient has history of intermittent claudication and which then increase to rest pain, sir. And the if claudication may be arterial, venous or neurogenic claudication.
Don't go on telling like that. At this juncture, yes, that we will ask you questions.
Yes,
that we will ask you. When I ask you a question, based on whatever you have written now, pain in the foot, severe, localized, and all that history you have written there. So I ask you, what do you think likely? You should tell it could be related to arterial
system. Yes, sir.
Don't go on telling it could be venous, it could be neurological types. Only when examiner asks you. Now you tell me, why do you think it is arterial claudication?
Sir, there is rest pain, sir, and pain is so severe, and pain decreases on hanging the foot down the bed, and it aggravates on elevating the limb, sir.
What you should tell is arterial claudication is severe, much severe.
Yes, sir.
You have written
yes,
that word. You is there in front of you, very severe. Now only few things are which are missing here is. You are not mentioned whether he has pain in the thigh or whether he has pain in the calf region. Have you mentioned that?
No, sir.
Now tell me, if the patient has got pain in the thigh, where yes, do you think the arterial obstruction?
Sir, one level above, sir, aortoiliac block it may be, sir.
Common iliac. If the pain is in the calf region, where is the obstruction?
Sir, it is in femoropopliteal junction, sir.
And in the femoropopliteal area, which are the common site where the obstruction occurs?
Sir, in the superficial femoral artery.
No, that is correct. That yes, is only one artery comes there is the superficial femoral artery. But yes, where in the superficial femoral artery, which are the areas where there is a turbulence? Or eddying currents. There could be some area of natural hiatus. I have given you a clue. So that is the area. Where is that area? You know the answer or you don't know? When you don't know, say, I don't know.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I don't know,
sir. So it is the hiatus of the adductor magnus. Okay. You have heard of the Hunterian canal in the anatomy?
Yes. Yes, sir.
Adductor
yes, sir.
Canal. So, yes, where the superficial femoral artery is passing there, just naturally there is I don't call it as a turbulence, some partial like obstruction. So, that is the area from there you can get a full length of whatever obstruction or a thrombus or etc. Right? So yes. That is one about the. So this patient has got pain in the foot. Right?
Yes, sir.
You should now tell me which side of the foot. Don't tell me left foot. Yes, in the left foot, it is on the left side that is called as lateral aspect or medial aspect. Have you asked this question? It's important.
What is the artery that comes below the knee?
Popliteal artery, sir.
The femoral continues as the popliteal.
Popliteal artery.
Popliteal, yes, divides into
anterior tibial and posterior tibial.
Posterior has got a common tibio-peroneal trunk.
Yes,
so
sir.
That is posterior tibial and the peroneal. So, yes, sir is asking, is it on the lateral or on the anterior side or on the medial side? You said left foot. First toe, you said. What is that first toe?
Sir, it is anterior aspect, sir.
So what answer I wanted was, you remember, one of the very common manifestation of a TAO is what has been called as instep claudication. That word you should instep, okay? I-N-S-T-E-P, instep claudication, because it is on the medial side. It is on the great toe. Especially this is the, what is the great toe? Functions. Do you know any idea? Great toe.
Sir.
Great toe.
What is the tendon there, ma? So you said you tendon
there. Extensor hallucis longus.
So that is the one muscle is there. Thick muscle. It does some function. You know, in the extending and flexion. So what you should try to understand is the pain in step is mainly due to the ischemia of those small muscles there. And that is what sometimes patient holds the foot. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Right? So that is called an instep. That is a, of course, dorsalis medius artery, little distally enters into the plantar space there. So you should know that. So when patient says, I have got pain in my left foot or right foot, find out where is the pain. Is it on the medial side or is it on the lateral side? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Right. Now, next question is that intermittent claudication, do you know the grades? Quickly tell me.
Yes, sir. Sir, intermittent claudication, we have Rutherford classification.
Don't bring Rutherford down. Simple Boyd's classification, you tell for the time.
Yes, sir. Boyd's classification in grade 1, patient gets pain on walking, but when he continues to walk, the pain disappears. In grade 2, pain still persists on walking and patient can walk with that pain. In grade 3, patient has to take rest to relieve the pain, sir.
So, you can always, this is the common question which is asked. There is a Fontaine classification in the stage as well as a Rutherford classification of grades are there. So, yes, if you know it, it's all right. Otherwise, yes, Boyd's is the minimum thing you should know as far as the, now, tell me, why there is rest pain?
Yes. Sir, because of increased stenosis.
No. First three grades of the intermittent claudication is because of ischemia of the muscle. Okay.
Yes, sir.
And last one is ischemia of the
nerves. So, due to involvement of vasa nervosum, sir.
So you know then why didn't you tell? So what Das had described it as a cry of the dying nerve, no?
Yes,
cry.
Sir.
Cry of the dying nerve. So it's just to remember, first three grades are due to ischemia of the muscles. I think you should read about it. It's an anaerobic metabolism takes place because of lactic acid production there, but resulting in pea substances that causes the pain. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes,
right.
Sir.
So now here is your patient who has got a pain in the foot for 4 months duration. You should have specifically asked, do you have any pain in the calf region or any pain in the thigh? Okay. You should have asked that question. Just want to know that somebody has raised the hand, it seems, asked the question. Can we make out that who has raised the hand and somebody wanted to ask
the question? The accident.
Sir?
Why this claudication distance is important, Tejasvini?
Yes. Sir, it shows the severity of the disease, and when the claudication distance decreases, it means the patient is ending in more severe disease.
More severe disease.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Does it come in any classification to walking?
Sir, I didn't get the question, sir.
No, does this claudication distance come in any classification?
More sir,
yes.
The Boyd's classification for intermittent claudication, sir.
No.
Distance, I'm asking.
Distance, sir, it comes in Fontaine classification, sir.
Yes, what is that?
There are four stages, sir. In stage one, there is no clinical symptoms. In stage two, the patient has intermittent claudication. It is again divided into 2A and 2B. In 2A, patient can walk more than 200 meters. That is well compensated. In 2B, he can walk only less than 200 meters and poorly compensated. Stage three is rest pain, sir. Stage four is gangrene or ulcers, sir.
Right, you have said very much. Now tell all about Rutherford also. Rutherford is the 19th. Came later,
sir,
1986
sir. Or 87. Sir, Rutherford, there are six grades, sir. In grade zero, asymptomatic. In one, mild claudication. Two, moderate claudication. Three, severe claudication. And four is, there is rest pain, sir, ischemic rest pain. Five and six, minor tissue loss and major tissue loss, sir.
Very good, very good.
So, what you should write is, Boyd's four is, four when I say ischemia of the nerve, is Rutherford 4. So Rutherford has added tissue loss. Tissue loss. Sir. So remember by that. So that you will not forget. Otherwise, Boyd also, you can call it as a mild, moderate, severe. We don't use that word. But I'm just trying to compare for you to easy to understand. So whenever you have a patient who comes with a pain in the foot, you should try to understand that first is it could be arterial disease. Yes.
Yes, sir.
You have asked all this question. It looks like it is arterial disease. Now tell me why the patient puts the leg on the either side of the foot hanging down.
Sir, because due to gravity, the blood flow will improve, sir.
One. Any other thing? Yes. Any other? Pain is usually ischemic pain is more in the night, correct? That is because you are most of the time lying down. Lying down is nothing but there's no gravity added action. Daytime, yes, you are walking. Daytime you are walking. Your attention is diverted. Daytime you have got a gravity aided blood supply. In the night there is nothing, so he gets severe pain. So he hangs it down. Maybe gravity, but there's hardly any blood. So there could be some venous stasis, reflux vasodilatation. And also, yes, he goes on pressing his foot or a calf muscle. No, he presses the hand. So that may help in a little bit of circulation, like a massage. So these are some of the factors which have been mentioned for the ischemic pain, relieved on hanging by the side of the whatever the bed. All right. Now, just next slide. Before we go to the gangrene portion or a blackish discoloration, I want to ask you one or two other questions. Other than the arterial disease, what are the causes of the pain in the foot? Pain in the foot.
Pain in the foot. Sir, it may be due to diabetic neuropathy.
Good. What type of patient, what type of pain will have? What type of the pain you get in a diabetic neuropathy in the foot? Please remember, I am asking for foot, not knee joint. Yes. Yes. What is that? It's called as peripheral neuropathy.
Peripheral neuropathy. So glove and stocking type of neuropathy.
Yeah, no. What is that? What do they complain to you? Something like a pin. So what is that?
Pin and needle sensation. So
some kind of a pin and, you know, prick type of a sensation. So when a patient says, I got pain in the foot, think of skin first. Any skin disease patient has got cracks, ulcers. Next, you have got tendinitis. Okay. Tendinitis. Then you need to talk about muscles. We said about instep claudication. Then you talk also about any joint pain. Okay, what is the, any idea, Morton's metatarsalgia? You know, metatarsalgia. So continuous standing, you can also have got some kind of a pain there. It's called a metatarsalgia. Okay.
Yes, sir.
You
yes, sir.
Also can have a fracture there. You know, heard of the March fractures and stress fractures, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Patient a smoker. He is a police constable. They do a lot of march fasting. And he comes and pain in the foot. You should not brand him as he has got a TAO because he may be having due to different reasons. Okay?
Yes, sir.
So, you have ruled out arterial disease. You have ruled out a neurological. Venous ulcers will not produce pain in the foot. Okay? Yes.
Yes, sir.
So, all these things you have ruled out now. Now, you describe the blackish discoloration. So, what do you think the cause of the blackish discoloration? What do you think the cause of blackish discoloration?
Sir, blackish discoloration, it may be due to gangrene, sir.
So, dry gangrene, what do you think the type of the gangrene you are dealing as you are starting looking at the patient? Wet gangrene or dry gangrene?
Sir, dry gangrene, sir.
So, why?
Sir, because arterial diseases and in if atherosclerosis...
No, I didn't ask you theoretical. Patient is in front of you.
Yes, sir.
You saw the lesion. And that's how you start talking to the patient. Patient has told you 3 months back, I have developed this liver blackening of the toe, etc. So what made you to think it could be dry?
Sir, there is a clear-cut line of demarcation is there, sir. There is no futures of infection, spreading infection.
So what you could have told me at this, sir, there is no smell, bad odor. Okay, which is bad odor. So whenever, so there is no bad odor, number one. Second is, if you are able to see the line of demarcation well, as they are examining, you should think that it could be mostly a dry gangrene, right? Why you don't get dry gangrene? Why you get dry gangrene? Sorry. In chronic.
Sir, it is due to aseptic ulceration, sir.
Sorry?
Aseptic ulceration, sir.
I not understood the septic ulceration.
Aseptic.
Aseptic ulceration, sir.
No, my question is, I'll put it other way. In a dry gangrene, whatever gangrene you get is a very small portion. Somebody has put there dry, mummified.
Yes, sir.
But in wet gangrene, it is a little more extensive. So, what is the reason for that?
Sir, in dry gangrene, there is no infection as such. But in wet gangrene, there will be superadded infection. So, it is more extensive, sir.
Any important reason? The reason what I answer I wanted is, dry gangrene is something like patient has been having claudication. So, that is itself is a body signal. It gives some time for the collaterals to open up. Okay?
That's
important now. See, your patient has got pain since 4 months and blackish discoloration 3 months. So, when the collaterals open up, they do supply the blood, but it may not be enough. So, the most distal portion, like toe, becomes gangrenous. Okay?
Yes,
so,
sir.
Your answer should be because of the collaterals. And if the question is asked on line of demarcation, then you should tell it is between living and dead, and with the development of ulcer there and becomes slowly deepened, then granulation tissue, that's what you should give an answer. Whereas in wet gangrene, what happens? Wet gangrene.
Sir, in wet gangrene, it is due to superadded infection with putrefaction. So there will be edematous and swollen, discolored parts.
I agree with you, but in relation to vascularity, tell me what happens in a wet gangrene. What are the cause of wet gangrene?
Sir, it may be due to diabetics, sir.
I asked you in relation to vascularity of the vessel. What are the causes of wet gangrene? Diabetes, okay, I'll take it. Any other, most important, you could give the answer, embolism.
Embolism.
Sudden occlusion. Somebody has put a sudden occlusion. Can you tell me what happens when there is a sudden occlusion?
Sir, sudden occlusion, there will be sudden loss of blood supply to the part, sir. And there is venous stasis will be there, sir.
So imagine an emboli is sitting in the femoral artery, common femoral. There is no time for the collaterals to develop.
Yes, sir.
It has happened suddenly. So, What is the result? Result is?
Complete loss of blood.
Massive gangrene. So it should be treated more urgently. Right. Now tell me important causes of emboli.
It may be due to atrial fibrillation or after MI, then atheroemboli, after any coronary post-surgery, coronary vascular intervention, then it may be due to aneurysm, sir.
So you start with the mitral valvular disease first, and of course you mentioned
infective endocarditis.
Infective endocarditis will not produce a arterial occlusive disease. It may produce a problem in the kidney, microscopic hematuria, etc. But it is not a problem in the producing this leg problem. Okay. So always think of a, in elderly people, it's atheroemboli. Atherosclerosis itself can cause emboli from the aorta or from the common ilium. Young patient means mitral valvular disease. Is it clear? Suppose that MI, post patient had MI means that's post a post myocardial infarction, neural thrombus. It can get clot, giving rise to emboli. So you should know sudden occlusion, you should think of emboli. The gangrene is massive, but slow occlusion is nothing but these are the cases where the collaterals develop. So the gangrene is limited to a small area, but if there is a diabetes now, superadded infection happens, so you get more of a problem, right?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Srinivasan, sir, you want to add anything?
No, emboli, I have typed in the chat, if you remember P, pain, pallor, pyoclothyrmia, paresthesia, paralysis, yes. And the limb is perishingly cold. Limb.
Correct. Six pieces.
I written in the chat box, you can watch it.
Yes. So now your patient has got 4 month history of pain and a 3 month history of a blackish discoloration. So according to you, by the history, you thought it could be related to arterial occlusion. And that with a 48-year-old means you have got to consider both. That's how you proceed now, right? Now can you go to the next slide? Yeah. So obviously, what is the difference between a slough and a gangrene?
Sir, slough is a dead solid tissue which is in situ, sir. It is in connection with the normal tissue. But in gangrene, it is macroscopic death of the tissue with superadded infection, sir.
That also will be with the tissue, no?
So sir, here infection... Sir?
We don't call skin which is a blackish as a slough. You try to understand. The gangrene is, yes, you are told, macroscopic death with superadded infection. Slough is always a dead subcutaneous tissue. What are the subcutaneous tissue? It can be fat, it can be muscle, it can be tendons, tendon sheath, connective tissue, anything. All that we remove, no? That's called debridement. When you have an ulcer, having also dead subcutaneous tissue, all this is a slough. Right. Now, it developed spontaneously, painful, hypersensitive. Why it is hypersensitive?
Sir, the arterial ulcers, they will be very painful, sir.
That's what I'm asking you. What is the reason for that? Because of the noxious, yes, stimuli. Means what are those nerve endings, you know, you get there?
Free nerve endings.
You know, there are 2-3 types of nerve endings are there, right? Delta fibers, C fibers, nociceptors. They are called as nociceptors. So they produce this kind of irritation when the nerve endings are exposed, right? Now, next is you have written about a diabetic status. In what way diabetes contributes for a arterial occlusive disease?
Sir, diabetes is a risk factor for atherosclerosis, and
then
there is infection and diabetic microangiopathy and diabetic neuropathy.
I asked you how does diabetics produce ulcer. I didn't ask you that. If a question is asked how does diabetes produce ulcer, then you have three things: vascular, neuropathic, right? You have got a vascularity. there is a neuropathy component, there's infection, correct. I asked you vascular complication. You should straight away say macroangiopathy and microangiopathy. Easy to remember. Give me what is macroangiopathy means.
Sir, macroangiopathy involves big vessels, sir.
Correct. Like example?
Sir, femoral, aortic.
You said now atherosclerosis, aorta, common iliac, femoral. Correct. So, microangiopathy?
It involves smaller vessels, sir.
Like?
It can involve capillaries and dorsalis pedis artery.
Not... What I want that I wanted is a high membrane thickening happens, you know. So the result is you get this problem in retina, you get this problem in kidney, you get this problem in the toe. Sometimes dorsalis artery is normal, but toe is gangrenous. How do you explain? You understand the question?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So it could be related to. It could be related to microangiopathy. So, diabetes can produce macro and micro. And if superadded by infection with atherosclerosis, and you know that is what is the result. Is okay? Right.
Yes, sir.
About the smoking. In what way smoking is important for a arterial occlusive disease?
Sir, smoking causes, smoking contains nicotine, it causes vasoconstriction. And smoking, it forms carboxy hemoglobin. So, which has more affinity towards oxygen causing hypoxia, sir.
Anything else? Basically, it's a vasospasm. So, what is the name of, what is the other name for Burgess disease?
Thromboangitis obliterans.
Can you explain me all those three terms? Thromboangitis obliterans. Can you explain those terms?
Sir, thrombo means there is thrombus formation.
Where?
In the vessel, angitis, it causing pain.
Just hold on. That's what I want. These are the common, sometimes they do mistakes. In atherosclerosis, the thrombus happens in the intima, correct?
Intima. Yes, sir.
That's why you know that thromboendarterectomy and all they do. Whereas in TO, it is in the media. It are micro abscesses. They are all micro. They are very small ones. Because this is a small and medium sized vessels. That is what will happen. Second, what happens to the angiitis means? Angiitis means?
Sir, pain, sir.
Inflammatory?
Inflammation.
Inflammation. A bacterial. There's no bacteria here. And obliterans means that's a obliterans. It's a small and medium sized vessels with microthrombus. They are not macro like atherosclerosis. You can't remove them. So that is what happens. So now your patient has got a smoker. And what is the smoking index? You heard of that?
Yes, sir. I heard of pack here, sir.
Yeah. Just tell me number of packs smoke into number of years. It is more than 30, so it could be significant. And also smoking index, that's more than 300. Okay. So these are two important things you should know as far as this disease is concerned. So smoking is a risk factor. Smoking index, that's nothing but whatever you are told just now. And third important thing is nicotine in any form for that matter. It can be a cigarettes, it can be a bidi, or it can be even a snuff dipping, or a snuff. Nicotine in any form can produce severe vasospasm. And of course, you have written about the harmful effect of the smoke. Can we change the slide now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you have written there left thigh, etc. Fainting attacks, abdominal pain. So I hope you know that each question when you ask, you should know why you are asking. Fainting and transient. Yeah, please go ahead. Yes, tell.
Sir, fainting and transient blackout, sir, to rule out the stenosis in the brain, sir. And
Brain. Don't say stenosis, brain.
You arterial stenosis, sir. Transient ischemic attack.
No, no, just hold on. Just hold on. It's a common carotid artery problem. So just think, don't say that inside the brain, we are not in common inside. So just like your atheroma, you can have atheromatous plaques in the common carotid artery. They can get dislodged. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
So don't say brain now. You say just common carotid artery occlusion. That simple word. Chest pain?
Chest pain due to coronary artery involvement, sir.
So abdominal pain?
Sir, mesenteric ischemia, sir.
So what is that pain called as? After 2-3 hours for the food you get. So it's called as postprandial pain. Okay.
Abdominal angina.
Post-abdominal angina, also called as a typical postprandial pain. Now, blurring of vision?
Sir, due to the involvement of retinal artery, sir, and so ophthalmic artery.
What is that called as? Amaurosis fugax.
Fugax.
So, these are the few things you should know. So, whenever you have got a vascular case, it is a systemic disease. Atherosclerosis is basically a systemic disease. So, you need to ask about the leg. So, in the leg, first it's honestly you are told, is it acute or chronic? In your case, it is chronic. So, I will keep the emboli away. This is how you should think in the mind now. So, it's a chronic disease. Okay, patient is a smoker who is 48. So, what is that I would like to think at this juncture? Probably, it is a 50-50 zone of a TAO as well as atherosclerosis. But I go more for TAO. Next comes. What are the important findings which you have seen in the inspection? That is the gangrene area, then the ulcer. These are the two things. Why that gangrene developed? Because of ischemia. Why there is a odor or a discharge? Okay, it may be having diabetes. So infection is there. Where is this claudication? It is in the foot. So I personally feel the problem may be related to popliteal artery or downwards. That is what you should, your mind should start thinking at this stage. And yes, you should also think of now whether he has got a other system in involvement, as I mentioned. So why not it is a neurogenic claudication? Why not it is a venous? Venous claudication issue will not come in this patient because it is in the toe. The problem is in the toe. Srinivasan, sir, you want to add anything, please, sir?
No, she left out gluteal claudication.
Gluteal claudication
and importance. What is that, sir, you asked? Tejaswini, you know, but
Lerish no syndrome. Lerish syndrome, sir.
What is the triad of Lerish syndrome?
Don't know, sir.
Gluteal claudication, absent femoral pulse, importance. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So this is not. So Mohammad Asal, he writing it, wrote correctly, Azharuddin, but mind the spelling, please. Some great people have discovered. L-I-R-C-H-E, Lerish syndrome. It is so not Lerish.
What you should try to understand is, you should tell iliac bifurcation saddle bag thrombus. Okay. What is saddle thrombus means?
Sir, at the level of bifurcation, thrombus is there.
Saddle means saddle. You know, horse, you might not have been saddle. So, you know, when you sit on the horse, you put that, no? Saddle bag.
That position of the horse. Position you sit in the horse, you call this saddle position.
So
the bifurcation is called saddle. The correct. Thrombus occurring in the bifurcation is called Lerish syndrome. So that is one you mentioned, but probably you forgot. That's why you have written about abdominal angina, everything. So gluteal claudication is very important.
I wrote in family history. He is married with and has 3 children. So I wrote
that
in
the old. You want to know in last 4 months what has happened?
Last 4 months. Importance, okay, not importance. I'm telling. Anyway, he's got now as he developed, is the thrombus extending on to the aortoiliac region? If the disease is progressing, since you wrote about abdominal angina, chest pain, blurring of vision, I added this point, okay? Don't forget, no problem.
So, one question to you, how do you differentiate arterial claudication of rest pain from neurogenic claudication? Neurogenic.
Sir, in neurogenic claudication, there is a pain at the starting point only, and it relieves in some position like bending forwards, and pain relieves on rest after more than 5 minutes.
Yes, yes. So first step means as soon as you put your foot on the ground itself, you get pain, whatever it be, maybe a disc prolapse or whatever be the cause, TB spine or injuries or whatever it is. So that is one thing they will ask you. Slightly on forward bending, it becomes better. That is what is the neurogenic claudication. And of course, venous claudication, would have already heard it in a varicose pain. So, all right. Shall we proceed, sir?
Yes, sir. Sir. Please, sir.
Yeah. Anything positive for the past history you would like to ask in this patient? Apart from tuberculosis, asthma, epilepsy, why do you want to ask epilepsy in your patient?
Sir, like common past history, I have asked.
Everybody will have epilepsy then? So it's not required. So don't ask all these questions because you are talking about a patient. So we would like to know only about tuberculosis, common disease in India. Asthma, because you may require an anesthesia for it. Coronary artery disease, definitely yes. So like that, there's no end. So don't have to mention epilepsy, etc., etc. If patient give the history, you tell. Otherwise, not required. What is the difference between amputation and disarticulation?
Sir, amputation is what we do in the bones, sir. Disarticulation is in between the joints.
So how do you know this patient has undergone amputation? You have seen this patient. Of course, you have got a better idea. So always try to make a point very clear. So it's if it is a disarticulation, it is through the joint. In the initial part, we don't close the wound. If there's a gangrenous portion, means you just disarticulate. And later you refashion and maybe you do amputation or closure later. Just make up a point there. No, it's your major surgery or long-term hospitalization. Okay, go ahead. Next.
Yes, sir. Drug history, sir.
Yeah, patient is diabetic, so he's taking these drugs. Patient has got hypertension. So is he got any other drugs which are necessary for hyperlipidemia?
Statins.
Yeah,
he's not taking.
So why did I ask that question?
Sir, statins decreases the lipid level. So atheroembolic reason can be.
What you want to know is whether the patient has got investigated for hyperlipidemia by somebody and whether the patient is starting on any statins for the decreasing the levels of the cholesterol. That is what you should try to know, right?
Yes, okay.
Yes, please go ahead. Next.
Personal history, sir.
He consumes
mixed diet, appetite is normal, sleep disturbed, bowel and bladder habits are normal and regular, non-smoker, smokes 4 to 5 cigarettes per day for the last 20 years, consumes alcohol occasionally. And family history, married and has 3 children, no history of similar complaints in the family, no history of myocardial infarction, stroke in the family.
Don't make a blanket statement of no history of similar complaints in the family. Do you expect his wife and 3 children also should have all the same complaint? No. That is relevant only when you think of genetic diseases, younger child, whatever be the reason, maybe hemochromatosis or, for example, polycystic kidney or hemophilia. So in your patient who is acquired disease, this is not required. No, it's just similar complaints. What you can maximum say is if his father had a stroke, yes, it becomes relevant. Father or maybe a brother. So don't make such blanket statement in the family. Family refers to his family, close family, right? So siblings is more important here. Father, that is more important. All right. Yes. Okay, go ahead.
Samaj, sir. 48-year-old gentleman.
You go to the inspector, you go to the clinical examination, ma. This sir has described everything. Okay, this is your picture, isn't it? Very good.
Sir, it is just a picture that I have taken from net, sir.
No problem.
They told me not the actual representative. Go ahead, please.
Map picture, one toes disarticulate. Yes.
Sir, general physical examination. Patient is conscious, coherent, cooperative, well-oriented to time, place, and person. Comfortable with legs hanging below the level of bed. Consent is taken. He is moderately built and nourished. Height 155 centimeter, weight 55 kg, BMI 22.89 kg per meter square, Pallor is present, no icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, generalized lymphadenopathy, and pedal edema.
Just hold on now. Go back. Yeah. I have seen that. That is fine. That's a typical posture of the legs hanging. So one look should tell you that it is an arterial disease. Okay. So that's what you differentiate at every level, starting from the age I mentioned to you, starting from the age, starting from the history, your mind should start working. What is that you are dealing with? So now legs are hanging below the level of the bed, right? Now it's pallor. Why pallor? Why anemia is important?
Sir, anemia, it deals with the improvement in the wound healing.
So perfusion.
And anemia is decreased hemoglobin. So hypoxia, it adds to the disease process.
So just say for the perfusion purposes, the ulcers, he has got ulcer that has to heal. So that is the reason why you would specifically look for the pallor here. Other things are not very important. Icterus, cyanosis, especially in your patient, clubbing, generalized lymphadenopathy, pedal edema. If this patient has got pedal edema, what do you think?
Sir, edema means there is infection.
So in your patient, you should say probably, sir, he's got diabetes. So there is an infection of the foot. So that is a cellulitis. What is the difference between cellulitis and abscess?
Sir, cellulitis is involving the subcutaneous skin and subcutaneous tissue, sir. It is not a spreading disease.
Not truly skin. It's a spreading subcutaneous inflammation. Abscess means?
Sir, it is a pus-filled cavity, sir, surrounding the granulation tissue.
Not localized collection of the pus. Localized. It's surrounded by a pyogenic membrane, not truly a granulation tissue. Is a pyogenic membrane with the pus. So it's localized. Cellulitis is spreading. All right. Sir. Next.
Sir, vitals, blood pressure 134/90 mm Hg in both the arms and in supine position. Pulse rate 100 beats per minute. Right radial, regular rhythm, normal volume, normal in character, no radio radial delay, no radio femoral delay. In upper limb, no vessel wall thickening is seen. And in respiratory rate, 16 cycles per minute, temperature 98.5 degree Fahrenheit, sir.
Yeah, just hold on here. Just hold on. Yeah, radial artery you can mention here, but what you should say is, sir, I will mention the pulses later at the end. Both lower limb as well as upper limb as well as head and neck. Is okay? Yes, this is a case of an arterial disease. Okay? So, no doubt you have mentioned there, but we need a more information, especially in the arterial disease. You have written there wall thickening. Why wall thickening?
Sir, atherosclerosis. So there is wall thickening.
Yes. What is that you call the such brachial artery as thickened artery?
Locobrachialis.
Locomotor. Locomotor brachialis. Also called as a dancing brachialis. Locomotor brachialis. Also called as a dancing brachialis. If it is present, means you can close your eyes and give a diagnosis, sir, this is atherosclerosis. See, you have a doubt here, 48-year-old fellow, 45-year. But he has got a dancing brachialis, means over. It is atherosclerosis. You don't get it in a TAO. Okay. Yes, go ahead. Next.
Sir, local examination. Patient is explained about the procedures and is examined in supine position under adequate light exposure. Both the lower limbs are completely exposed from the level of anterior superior iliac spine to the tip of the toes. Next slide. Inspection of the left lower limb. Attitude of the limbs. Legs hangs down the bed. First toe is amputated, and there is black mummified appearance. Dry gangrene of remaining toes with blackish discoloration of entire foot and lower part of the leg till 2 cm above the malleolus with clear line of demarcation. The left leg below the knee shows signs of ischemia like thinning of skin, loss of hair and subcutaneous fat, and loss of luster. The nails show transverse ridges and are brittle. There are two ulcers, 5 x 4 cm over the dorsum of foot and 5 x 3 cm over the lateral malleolus. Both the ulcers are irregular in shape and punched out with irregular margin, gray fibrotic tissue on the floor. Extensor tendons are exposed on the dorsum of the foot. and lateral malleolus is exposed on the lateral side. No discharge is found over the ulcer. Surrounding skin is dry and pale. Wasting of calf muscles noticed in left lower limbs. And bulgus vascular angle, toes already gangrenous, indicating severe ischemia. Capillary filling time is prolonged more than 20 seconds. And venous refilling, veins are guttered and delayed refilling is noticed. Thigh of the affected limb appears normal and the right lower limb appears normal. No engorged vein.
Before we go to the palpation, just go to the inspection. First slide. Yeah, just hold on to that. It's important that you don't have to say that in the exam signs of ischemia. Please remember, your duty is to talk like a lawyer. You don't commit and say there is signs of ischemia. Number one. Number two, you should always start from the most distal part of the body to the proximal, especially in a patient who has got a vascular problem. No doubt you are told that thinning of the skin, etc. But what I want to remember is start from the pulp space of the most distal, from the toes. I'm talking about the toe, not from the hand, obviously. Because that normal, nice convexity is there, that will be lost. Because they get the least blood supply. In an arterial disease, most distal part of the body gets the least blood supply. So this convexity becomes flat in the toes, right? And then that nail you have written there already, interdigital ulcers or a cracks, if it is present, mention. Then you have come to the skin over that, you have written there, thinning of the skin, shininess, etc., etc. All right. After that, you describe that if there's a gangrene, it's very obvious, you straight away go ahead with the gangrene. All right. Once that is done, you should go slowly up and say the muscles, especially before you reach the thigh, you should have given an idea about the calf muscle. Any muscle atrophy is there on inspection.
And sir, the limb, I told, sir.
Yeah, okay. And the limb color of the limb. All right.
Yes, sir.
When you say that, you know, all this thinning of the skin, subcutaneous fat, examiner will ask you, what does it represent? Tell me now, what does it represent?
Signs of ischemia, sir.
You better use the word signs of chronic ischemia. Okay?
Okay,
these are all the signs of chronic ischemia.
Yes, sir.
That means to say it indicates fascio venous compartment ischemia. Please remember that word. What happens is the body is now diverting the nature, whoever who has given this body, diverting the blood from the fascio venous compartment to the muscle compartment. Is it clear now?
Yes, sir.
So, first one to suffer are these. You know, these are not required actually. Skin, hair, loss of all the shininess, etc. But we need the muscles. We need the muscles. They're like a priority basis now. So, diversion of the fascio-venous compartment blood to the muscular compartment is causing all these complaints. All right. Yes, sir. Right. Yeah, that ulcers, I think, describe when there are 2-3 ulcers, best is to say, sir, I will describe one big ulcer. And if there's any other ulcer has got any specific feature, you tell. Because very difficult to go on explaining in a limited time. So, whatever the dorsum of the foot, that 5x4 ulcer is there. So, you should give all the details like you do, like ulcer examination. Starting from the inspection number, floor, edge, all the surrounding area, etc. Right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, wasting of the calf muscle, she has already mentioned on the left side. Yes, next slide. Now, in a patient who is the dark skinned, like typically happens, difficult to appreciate the Burgess vascular angle. Is it called as vascular angle or any better term? Maybe the recent books would have changed the name. I do not know. Yes, please. It's called as
Burgers angle of vascular insufficiency.
Burgess angle of circular insufficiency. You know, it's a Burgess angle of circulatory insufficiency. So that's important. So that as you raise, slowly if you look at the color change, then you know at 30 degree or 40 degree or 20 degree, depending upon which you note in relation to the bed. Patient is horizontal. So he's raising the leg.
Yes, sir.
Burgess angle up. As the leg becomes elevated, it becomes pale.
Yes.
It becomes, when you lie down, it becomes a natural. And when you hang down, what will happen?
Dependent
rubber, especially because of the stasis and gravity. So that is so that is what you should look for in a Burgess angle of circulatory insufficiency. Capillary filling, veins are gutted because there's hardly any blood there, empty. Yes. Thigh is normal, right lower limb appears normal, no engorged veins. Srinivasan sir, anything you want to ask, sir?
No, sir. So somebody had asked about capillary filling type. It is not possible in the dark colored individuals.
Exactly.
I said it's not necessary. Capillary filling, venous refilling is not necessary.
All these are given in books. They should know. Otherwise, not required, actually.
Ask you the question, what is the normal, when do you say the Burgess angle of vascular insufficiency is dangerous? When do you say it, the angle when it becomes
less than 30 degrees, sir.
What is venous filling time? What is venous capillary refilling time? They may ask you. Okay, theoretically, some examiners would like to ask you the basics you know. I had asked what is ischemia, what is infarction? The basic thing I'm asking you, simple question.
Yes, sir.
Ischemia is the reversible stage of tissue hypoxia. Okay.
Yes, sir. Infection is irreversible.
Gangrene, you said. I had asked, what is mummification?
Dry and shriveled appearance is called.
It's called the typical definition is desiccation of the tissues. Of the tissues is called mummification. Now, when do you call it as pre-gangrene?
Pre-gangrene.
There are four things to say it's pre-gangrene. One is rest pain, edema, color change, hyperesthesia. Okay. Rest pain, edema, color change, hyperesthesia. This is what I wanted to add. Okay.
Yes.
Pre-gangrene. Yes, you proceed. Sir, can we proceed, sir?
Yes. Yeah, I told her. Please.
Sir, palpation, the left leg is cold when compared to right leg. Skin temperature feels normal just below the knee joint. Gangrenous toes are hard and shriveled. Black mummified appearance, dry gangrene of remaining toes, loss of sensation with black discoloration of entire foot and lower part of the leg till 2 cm above the malleolus with clear line of demarcation. Tenderness is noticed at the junction of gangrenous area and normal tissue. And cross leg test or a Fushing test, oscillatory movement of left leg is noted. And movements of the joints at intertorsal, mid-tarsal, ankle joint, movements are lost. At knee and hip joint, movements possible. And in motor system examination, tone of the thigh muscles are normal. Power of the muscles are normal. But in calf region, bulk of the muscle decreased. And circumference measurement in calf region, it is right side 35 centimeter and left side 29 centimeter. And in thigh, in both the side, it is 50 centimeter. And sensory system of the left leg, crude and fine touch, pain sensation, temperature sensation above the ankle, above 2 centimeter, above the medial malleolus is normal. And hyperesthesia of left foot is present. Patellar reflex present on both the sides. Ankle reflex not able to elicit in the left foot. And plantar reflex is absent. Regional lymph node examination normal, sir. And then palpation of peripheral vessels.
Tejasvini, just hold on. Tejasvini.
Yes.
After the initial, show me the palpation slide. Yeah. If there is a gangrene, you explain. That is no doubt about that. Okay. Now, gangrenous toes are hard. What is this hard? Why it came suddenly hard there? Why hard? It will not be hard because you are feeling the bone, I think. So don't worry. It's not required. Say what you have to say is the gangrenous toes are shriveled and mummified. That's enough. Okay. Don't bring the word hard now. And again, as I told you, you should say the line of demarcation and the discharge there. So if you say clearly, examiner asks you, what do you call it as? Then you say dry gangrene. Okay? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
And then you are written there, left leg is cold when compared to right leg. One or two important things. How did you examine for temperature?
Sir, from proximal to distal, sir.
Like what did you do with your hand?
Sir, from the dorsum of the hand, I examine the temperature. I compare both the limbs, starting from the thigh and ending up distally, sir.
First start from the normal side, yes. Okay? And then you check for the opposite side and use the dorsum, thin skin there and more of a hypersensitive, more sensitive,
cutaneous lot of cutaneous receptor.
Nerve end. In the palmar side, it is more thicker here. So we test with the dorsum of the hand and you start from above down so that you know the roughly which level the limb is cold. Okay, yes, right?
Sir.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
This Fuchsik test, books have given, it is not important test, neither it is easy to follow nor to demonstrate also. I think better not mention. If you say later in a popliteal artery, you are going to examine properly. So this is not required at this stage. No examiner will punish you. All right. If you know it, fine. If they ask you in a theory part. Yes. Next.
Yes.
All this should not come now. Okay. That's what I would like to mention. Your patient has got a more of an arterial disease. So you need to put those palpation of the pulses chart. Important. Only at the end of the examination of the peripheral pulses, these movements, motor system, all that should come. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
All right. Otherwise, yes, what happens is you will not have time in the university examination. You have got a limited time. And if you go on testing for all these things, at the end you will feel short. And what is your patient's complaint, major complaint?
Pain in the foot, arterial problems.
Arterial. If this patient is a paralytic patient in a neurology ward, okay, hemiparesis, hemiplegia,
yes, sir.
Then this will come first. Okay.
Yes, sir.
This will come. Motor system. All this. And don't worry, surgeons do not know much about examination of the neurological system. So you don't have to worry about it. So what I am trying to tell is, don't waste your time. Okay. So you've got a limited time. Arterial disease, gangrene is there. So this will come later. Quickly. So only we are interested in the where exactly you examine the pulses. Show the pulses chart.
That is that should come first, Ma. That slide.
Yes.
And this come in the way. You will. Nothing wrong. You put one slide again. That's all.
Palpation of peripheral vessels in right and left lower limb. Dorsal is...
Just hold on. Why did you mention that first statement? No tenderness noted while palpating vessel.
Sir, if it is varicose veins, there will be tenderness.
So what
and,
is
the
varicose veins, you are palpating veins.
Why you get tenderness in varicose veins? Yes. You are there, Priyanka Tejaswini?
Yes, sir.
You don't know or you know? That's all. Simple.
No, sir.
Thrombophlebitis. Thrombophlebitis. It's a known complication happens, right? Varicose veins. So that's what you said, no? In a patient who has got a TAVO can have a tender vein, but he will not have a tender vessel. Try to understand the difference.
Okay, sir.
You understood TAVO patients can get a superficial thrombophlebitis. What is that called as?
Hello, sir.
A patient who has got TAVO,
yes, sir,
can get
thrombophlebitis
of the veins, correct?
Yes, sir.
What is that called as? Any idea? Some sign? Yes, somebody has put that migratory. Yes. Migratory superficial thrombophlebitis, right? Throsiostein, yes, right? So, superficial migratory thrombophlebitis, originally described, of course, for visceral malignancies, pancreatic cancer, etc. Okay.
Yes, sir.
See, this is not required. Please remove that in your arterial examination. We don't come across this commonly, right? We are talking about TAO and atherosclerosis now. Even a Takayasu disease, etc., giant cell arteritis, it's a thickening is an important issue. Thickening. You don't get that tender vessels. Yes. One or two important questions. Where did you feel dorsal pedis artery?
Sir, in the dorsum of the foot, lateral to the tendon of extensor hallucis longus, at the just over the navicular and cuneiform bones.
So usually it is a navicular comes there. Somebody has put a first web space. No, it is wrong. Don't go distally. Don't go distally in the web space, etc. Better to say at the proximal. Same what you told is right. Extensor hallucis. You what you do is you contract the extensor hallucis. Make the patient to extend the toe. Extend the toe. You can see the nice extensor. Just lateral to it. Proximal space at the level. Actually, you get the navicular bone there. Bony prominence of the navicular. So there you examine for the dorsalis pedis artery. Can it be absent?
Yes, sir. In 10% people, it is absent, sir.
Where did you feel for the posterior tibial artery?
Now, why can't you palpate this distally, ma?
Sir, it then enters into the plantar aspect to form the plantar arch, sir.
Yeah, it dips into the first space and forms the plantar arch. It joins the plantar arch. That is why the book gives you, you don't palpate it distally, palpate it proximally.
Yes, sir.
Okay. As I said, extend and palpate, it's easy. It is absent in 10 to 20% of the people, it is absent. Okay. Sir, asked anterior tibial.
Sir, anterior tibial artery is in between the two malleoli, just lateral to the extensor hallucis longus tendon over the ankle joint. And the posterior tibial artery is midway between the medial malleolus and tendo Achilles tendon.
Keep the leg a little bit of external rotation, okay, for the posterior tibial, okay,
yes,
right?
Sir.
So you can mark the tendo Achilles as well as the medial malleolus properly. Popliteal artery.
Sir, there are three methods of doing in supine position, prone position, and cross leg test, sir. In supine position, we will flex the knee up to 45 degree and we will palpate the popliteal artery against
Where do you keep your thumbs?
Thumbs where are in front of tibial tuberosity, two thumbs, and the fingers are behind in the popliteal fossa. We flex the knee to relax the popliteal fascia and we palpate the artery against the upper end of tibia, sir.
You say upper end, that is the lower aspect of the popliteal fossa.
Yes, sir.
Yes, good.
And even we do in prone position, we flex the knee to 90 degree and we palpate in the lower part of the femur.
So, Tejaswini, one question sometime they may ask you so that to give you a gold medal or more marks. Without putting much efforts, popliteal artery is palpable means what?
Sir, popliteal artery aneurysm, sir.
Very good. So, you already got a good marks. Okay. So, as you just put your hand, you feel the popliteal artery means it's aneurysm. Do you know the length of popliteal artery?
Sir, 20 centimeters.
Oh, not bad. Do you know the shape of the popliteal fossa?
Sir, popliteal fossa is diamond shape.
Oh, good. So she's studied and come. Good. The point is important
here. One more question, sir. The common cyst seen in the popliteal fossa?
Baker's cyst.
Full name. Some Moran Baker's cyst. Okay.
Yes, sir. Moran.
Right. Moran Baker's cyst. Yes. Good.
Where do you feel the femoral artery?
Sir, in the mid-inguinal point, just below the inguinal ligament, sir. Mid-inguinal point is point between the anterior superior iliac spine and pubic symphysis, sir.
So what you should mention is that in a thin patient, especially a patient who has got a low BMI, even a femoral artery is a visible. Please remember this point. So always you should mention, sir, I have done inspection. Femoral artery is whatever, seen or not seen. Palpation, you palpate that. Actually, which bone you will palpate the femoral artery?
Head of the femur, sir.
It is in a thin patient. So, do you know any sign which is described?
Vascular sign of Narath, sir.
Good. So, vascular sign of Narath. In a dislocation, it happens. It pushes the femoral artery. Good. So, you should try to palpate for the femoral artery. And anything else you do for femoral artery other than palpation? Anything else? Look for bruit or a thrill. Okay. So palpation wise, thrill. And later, don't forget to auscultate. All patients, when you suspect, especially atherosclerosis, make a habit to auscultate the femoral artery as well as popliteal artery for any popliteal aneurysm. That should be the policy. Right. Yes. I think rest. I hope all of you know. Everybody, all the students should know this chart's very important, because your pass or fail depends upon these findings and this explanation. Ulcer, gangrene, claudication, all that six piece, acute ischemia, chronic ischemia, collaterals are the common. But the most important thing is this.
Sir, this chart in the case sheet, your long case sheet, you write it impresses the examiner.
Examiner.
So all of you take a screenshot, or you can have it. You can make it like this, 1+, 2+. This chart, if you put it, the examiner while correcting the long case sheet will impress and give you a mark. This is for the UG.
So that's what is very important. You should know which artery, and you should know specialties. When I say dorsal aspidus can be absent even in normal, posterior tibial, popliteal, methods of palpation. Why it's palpated in the prone position? You said supine prone fixation. Correct?
Yes, sir. Supine and prone and cross-legged.
The advantage of examining in the prone position. Simple.
Their popliteal artery is in the posterior compartment, so easy that, to palpate.
You can see, no? See, your eyes are better. Whereas in a supine position, what will happen?
Have to feel. Not, I can't see.
You can't see, you can feel. That is why in the supine position, with your thumb anteriorly, you have to run your finger little medial lateral. Sometimes what happens is, so you may be able to not get it sometimes, especially in a obese patients. Whereas in the prone position, you can see right in front what exactly you are doing. Okay. So that's one of the reasons. So, but only inconvenience is you have to make the patient sleep prone.
Yes, sir.
Severe vascular disease is having severe pain. So even a little movement, little touching here and there causes severe pain. Right? Only I will ask you randomly one other question. Where did you examine for subclavian artery?
Subclavian artery in the supraclavicular fossa at the midclavicular point, sir.
At this stage,
while stretching the shoulder to relax the deep cervical tissue. Sir.
So what is the meaning of the word subclavian means? Why is it called a subclavian? It is behind the clavicle, right?
Yes.
It is not easy to palpate the subclavian unless, again, thin patient, shrugging the shoulder and trying to insinuate your finger, especially the middle, what you are feeling. If you find, just like I asked you that popliteal artery one question, if you find a very prominent subclavian artery, what is your diagnosis? I have given you a clue. Upper limb ischemia. Young patient. Upper limb ischemia. Young patient. Prominent subclavian.
Then.
Yes. Go ahead. Takayasu. No, takayasu affect subclavian. Young patient. Young girl has come with the
Raynaud's disease.
Cervical rib. Somebody has put thoracic outlet, cervical rib. Raynaud's does not affect the subclavian. Okay. So it is a, what you should say is, cervical rib with the post-stenotic dilatation, thoracic outlet. So these are the importance of looking after various pulses. So subclavian artery, you palpated. Brachial, I mentioned about locomotor. And where do you feel the common carotid artery?
Sir, common carotid artery is medial to sternocleidomastoid muscle at the upper border of thyroid cartilage. Again, it's C6 carotid tubercle, sir.
So what you, okay, it's fine, but at the level of upper border, it bifurcates. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So you have to feel little below. Okay. So again, the C6.
Tubercle.
What is the tubercle called as?
Sir. Chaisagnes tubercle.
Chaisagnes tubercle. That is the C6 transverse process. So that is what you should try to feel. And this is what we mean by pulses chart. Everybody should put a nice pulses chart here so that you will not have any problems. So examination of the peripheral arterial occlusive disease. I don't call it as a peripheral vascular disease. I say peripheral arterial occlusive disease should include examination of the ulcer, examination of the gangrene, examination of the for evidence of chronic ischemia, which you already mentioned, and a beautiful pulses chart. That is in addition to a limb palpation temperature you have mentioned, and two tests, not very important, angle of circulatory insufficiency, venous refilling. Fascic test also rarely done. Okay. Right. Can we see the next slide?
Yes. Upper limb examination.
I wanted to tell you, I have gone through it yesterday. This is not required in your patient. Is it clear? Don't make it a habit unless your patient complains to you. I will ask you one question. Between a TAO and atherosclerosis, which one affects the upper limb?
TAO.
It is TAO. Atherosclerosis does not affect the upper limb. It can cause emboli. It is a different issue. But atheroma will not occur usually in the upper limb. Is it clear? So what I'm trying to tell is, these are not to be done. You have less time here. You say radial artery is normal. Brachial artery is normal. Enough. No complaints. So it's not required to do Allen's test, East test, Addison's test, etc. Okay, just manage with the lower limb pulses, but pulse examination you do. We don't say that don't do the pulse examination.
Yes, sir.
The next slide.
Examination of right lower limb, sir. No signs of ischemia noticed on inspection. Burgers test, marked pallor noticed at 45 degree. Capillary filling time and venous filling time,
sir. I can say normal, I think. Sir said, he said, you can say the examination of the right limb, the pulses are normal. You can just say it is normal. Okay.
There is a history of prolongation of capillary filling and venous filling time, is there? And numbness of toes is present on palpations.
They will ask you, the moment you said numbness, what do you think the cause?
You are dragging the examiner, ma. You can say very well normal. And escape with numbness means it becomes bilateral, almost so, bilateral. The other one extending onto the one, then they will go ask the causes. Okay.
So what is the cause for the numbness? At least diabetic neuropathy. Okay. Next question they will ask you, what is the earliest sensation lost in the diabetic neuropathy? Yes. Come on. Try. Somebody has already answered in the chat box. Vibration sense. Is the patient has got a clawing, you know, claw. So all these questions will come. So please be careful when you write these words, numbness. Yes, you are told as it is, but you should know. Sir, mostly is having diabetic neuropathy. Enough. Then you should be ready. What are the other components of neuropathy? All right. Okay, next.
Systemic examination, cardiovascular system, S1 and S2 heart.
So we'll put this and go to the diagnosis. Okay.
Yes,
summary, yes, read.
Summary, here is a 48-year-old gentleman patient who is a known diabetic, hypertensive and current smoker, has come with pain in the left foot since 4 months and blackish discoloration of left.
Current smoker, first time I'm hearing this. Current smoker or chronic smoker, I don't know. Who gave you this?
Sir, there is smoking history and he left the smoking.
He has restarted. No, he is called a smoker. Okay, chronic smoker. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, tell. Go ahead. Don't say current smoker. Yeah.
Sir. has come with pain in the left foot since 4 months and blackish discoloration of left foot since 3 months. On examination, left lower foot, first and second toes, first toes are amputated, other toes and foot showing the features of dry gangrene with the two arterial ulcers over the left foot and lateral malleolus. Both capillary and venous filling time delayed. Features of arterial ischemia present in the left leg. Burgess test positive. No regional lymph node enlarged.
When you are asked to say that, this is not the summary what you should write about all those Burgess test and lymph node, etc. Okay. You have to straight away say dry gangrene affecting whatever be the foot, whatever the toes, and post-surgical status. Post-surgical status means patient has undergone surgery. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Next slide. Yeah.
Sir, final diagnosis, a 45-year-old gentleman with the peripheral arterial disease of left lower limb with the arterial ulcer and dry gangrene of left lower foot, probably tibial artery stenosis due to atherosclerosis.
Why did you say tibial artery stenosis?
Sir, based on the history, there is
leading stenosis, ma, you can probably involving the tibial artery would have been a better word.
Yeah.
Or which tibial artery? Stenosis, you cannot, is a not a clinical diagnosis, okay?
Yes, sir.
It may be, then they will ask, is it partial stenosis or full complete stenosis? So you change it into probably involving the anterior tibial or posterior tibial, or infrapopliteal segment will be a better term, which I think, okay?
Okay, sir.
Your patient has got a popliteal artery which is normal?
Yes, sir. Popliteal artery pulsation is normal, sir.
Both sides are normal?
Yes, sir.
So your answer should be tibial artery occlusion. Okay, whatever.
Okay.
We are talking about a peripheral arterial occlusive disease. That's all.
Yes, sir.
Whether it is a thrombus, whether it's an emboli, whether it's a stenosis, it's all complete. As Dr. Srinivasan has already clarified the issue. My question to you is that they will ask you at this stage, why not TAO?
Sir, there is a history of diabetic mellitus, hypertension, and smoking, and which more adds to the atherosclerosis.
When the question is asked, you should start from the age of the patient. And the most important thing is, of course, the smoking and the type of the vessel which is involved. What is the type of nature of the vessel involved in TAO?
Sir, small and medium sized vessels, sir.
And in
atherosclerosis, large vessels, sir.
So that is one. And what are the other signs of atherosclerosis you have got in this patient? Forget about smoking, diabetes, all that is comes the history and all. Now tell me, on clinical examination, what are the points to say it's atherosclerosis?
Sir, it is unilateral, sir.
So it's atherosclerosis, is it?
Yes, sir. In, if it is TAO, it commonly bilateral, sir.
You said other leg is also involved.
Sir, but
patient has got an infrapopliteal disease, Dr. Srinivasan is telling. There is no radial artery thickening. There's no bruit. There is no thrill. So what I'm trying to tell is, just get ready to face this situation in the examination. Your case is a little bit of, if you see carefully, the point, he may be diabetic. Nobody will deny that question. But look at his findings are only below the popliteal artery, right? So keeping that in mind, you may have to entertain, see, he's 45-year-old, just 5 years beyond 40. Now it's important that when he started smoking, right? When he started smoking. So if the people would have smoked at the age of 15 or 20 and the age is 45, he will still go for a TAO. It's all right. Let us not fight on this issue now. What you should try to understand is TAO is a small vessel and medium sized vessel disease. Atherosclerosis is a vessel disease. Apart from the diabetes and hypertension, there are no other findings in your patient to say atherosclerosis. But at least you should know the differences. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Srinivasan, sir, if any students are want to ask any questions about, they can ask one or two questions.
Is this limb a critical limb ischemia? And what is the importance of critical limb ischemia? What is critical limb ischemia? And sir, what is the importance of critical limb ischemia?
Sir, critical limb ischemia is the recurrent persistent pain for more than 2 weeks, requiring analgesic for more than 2 weeks, with ankle brachial pressure index of less than 0.3, sir.
Okay.
And showing the features of ischemia like ulcers or gangrene.
What is the importance of it?
Hello, sir.
What is the importance of critical limb ischemia? If a patient has got critical limb ischemia, there are certain factors. Is it not?
Yes, sir.
Number one, the patient will go in for 100% amputation within 6 months. Chance of contralateral ischemia, patient developing ischemia on the contralateral limb is there, 50%. Chances of MI is there. Chances of stroke is there, 25%. Okay, yes, these are the points to say well, the importance of critical limb ischemia. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
All of you should make a chart later and make two columns and write on one side TAO, another side atherosclerosis, and see where is the scale, you know, scale hangs, which side it goes. That's what you should practice in the university examination to give a final diagnosis in this patient. Right, what do you want to do now?
Sir, investigations and treatment, sir. Investigations.
Yeah, go ahead with the first, what is your aim in this patient? Aim.
Aim is to decrease the pain first.
Yes.
And then to revascularize the limb, sir. So, then to take care of gangrene parts.
All right. Now, I think it's already, time is 1 hour, 30 minutes reaching, Dr. Srinivasan.
Yes, sir.
So, we'll quickly go on to this investigations we have seen here. Basically, investigation to rule out atherosclerosis or that hypercholesterolemia. I think that part is clear there. If the patient has got diabetes, you have to treat it, no doubt about that. I think you now tell me about ABPI. Somebody was asking that time only. So this is the time, no doubt you should mention here, Doppler, also called as handheld Doppler, is the extension of clinical examination in a patient who has got an arterial occlusive disease. Okay? All right? Handheld Doppler.
Excuse me, sir. Sir, I'm Shravan, a core committee member from White Army. Sir, there's no restriction to end by 7:30, so we can continue the discussion, sir. Oh. As if we can complete it completely, it would be really nice.
I know, but...
Yes, sir.
So what I want to understand is, please remember, handheld Doppler is not truly an investigation, to put it that way. At the end of my clinical examination, I'll complete it with a handheld Doppler, right? Okay. Yes, yeah. Tell me, what is a handheld Doppler?
Sir, it is also called pocket Doppler, where...
Okay. Put in the pocket. Yes. No problem. Yes.
Sir, we will send a ultrasonic wave that gets reflected, and because of the moving red blood cells due to the iron content, and that reflected beam is converted into audio signal.
It's an audio signal because of the movement of the blood, which you know is heard as a signal. So you say that this is a whatever the heard or not heard. But our palpation with fingers, I cannot appreciate. Your Doppler may pick up the pulse. That forms basis for ABPI. What is ABPI?
Ankle brachial pressure index, sir.
So what is normal?
Sir, 0.9, above 0.9 is normal, sir. 0.9 to 1. And if it is less than 0.9, it indicates ischemia, sir. And less than 0.5 is severe ischemia, rest pain. Less than 0.3 is critical ischemia. And if it is more than 1.3, it is indicating calcification of the vessels seen in diabetics.
Okay. So what is important are two things here. At the end of the clinical examination, ruling out hypercholesterolemia, diabetic status, all that is over. Urine sugar is, you can mention nothing wrong, but blood sugar, GlycoHB is more important. And then straight away proceed with the handheld Doppler. And then you say, I will do ABPI so that I will get the ankle brachial pressure index to get some idea that where is this patient standing. Means whether he's going for a imminent gangrene, 0.3, imminent gangrene, or whether it is better than that, right? Okay, what is the duplex scan?
Sir, a duplex scan is it is a combined mode of Doppler with B mode of ultrasound, sir.
What is the advantage?
Sir, in brightness mode, we will come to know exactly the flow and color of the blood flow also can be seen, sir.
It's a Doppler with the B mode ultrasound. You know, there's a color coding there. You can identify the artery. You can identify the vein. You have got the transducer. Red color means the direction of the flow, whether it is towards the transducer or it is going away from there. So all the details can be made out and they will give a velocity or the values. You know, they will give the values. This is how it is. 60, 50, like that. So this is how you'll be able to make out the details in a duplex scan.
Yes,
so handheld Doppler should be immediately followed by duplex scan. Then you say, I will wait for the duplex scan results before you proceed with the treatment. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Now, before I ask you for the treatment of the thing, tell me, how do you look after his pain? If you have the slides, you can show.
Yes, sir. Next slide.
I saw somewhere. Go ahead.
For pain.
Go
ahead. Sir, for pain.
Go to the first slide. Go to the previous slide.
Yeah.
Yes. This is very, very, that stop smoking, you have said, and underlined. For this, you are given good marks. That is very good. Then your lifestyle modification. Very good. Okay. Yes.
Sir, treatment like stop smoking and regular exercise to control obesity. But for the pain, immediately I have to give him analgesics like diclofenac or aciclofenac, or I can give ketorolac 10 mg TID. And I advise him for stop smoking and regular exercise. Care of the limb I will take to avoid injuries. Then blood sugar and lipid control I will do. Then I ask him to maintain his toe in a confirmed position like burger's position, and heel rise of the shoes advised. Then other particular treatment like pentoxifilin 400 mg 2 times a day, that improves the microcirculation by decreasing the viscosity, and aspirin 75 mg OD and clopidogrel 75 mg OD, which are anti-platelet drugs, so it decreases the thrombus formation. And
I just want you all of you to know that list is big there. Which are the important drugs you tell in that list? At least two you should know, which are used routinely.
Yes, sir. Analgesics and celostazol.
No, celostazol is not the important drug at this stage. You just say aspirin and clopidogrel. Okay, these are the two drugs which are used. Antiplatelet, aspirin, blood thinners. Okay, pentoxifilin. We used to use, not much of benefit. Pass them, they will say no. Celostazol, unless patient has got a specific indication of a hypercholesterolemia, and usually that is also not routinely used. But
the patient is already taking metformin, sir. So I think that is, it should, dose should be halved, or it has not been used. Celostazol, these are all not particularly very useful.
Aspirin and clopidogrel. These are the two important drugs. So what you should tell is that, lifestyle modification, in that all that will come. Smoking, cholesterol control, diabetic control, all that will come. And then second one is about this care of the ulcer. Care of the ulcer. Regular dressings, culture sensitivity, x-ray of the foot. We would like to rule out any infection. That's what forms the care of the ulcer. Analgesia, care of the ulcer. Drug therapy. chemical sympathectomy is not done nowadays. So forget about chemical sympathectomy. Just drugs in this, which may help, that is aspiration and clopidogrel, antiplatelets and blood thinners. That's what you call them as. They help in some kind of a, you know, healing of the ulcers also. So these are the two drugs which are commonly used. Pentoxifilin alters the shape itself, you know, that alter the shape of the RBCs and helps to a little bit. Yes, but their role is doubtful. Nowadays, they don't recommend at all.
They do.
Vascular surgeons. Yes. Next.
And other
can you use vasodilators?
Sir, recently they told vasodilators are not so useful.
Recently, no, from the first it's not, because already there is some amount of blood flow to the, some small amount. You give a vasodilators, the blood, the big vessels, all the blood flow, it gets diverted. So the blood which is flowing even to the ischemic limb, small amount of blood is not, is stealing. Stealed away. So don't give vasodilator. Okay.
So just to quickly, whether it's arterial TAVO or atherosclerosis, start with the, when it comes to treatment, sir, I will look after his analgesia. I will look after the care of the ulcer. I will manage the, so lifestyle modification advice, whatever give. I will give the drugs to look after that, whatever two important drugs you mentioned. And then, of course, you would like to know the report of the Doppler and a Doppler scan, and if they say this is the only the small vessel disease, small vessel like your patient, yes, only the posterior tibial artery and say anterior tibial artery is involved, what will you do? Small vessel disease. Now you are stuck because you said small vessel. So all this will never come now. Okay. PTA, percutaneous angioplasty, endarterectomy, thrombectomy, atherectomy, nothing will come. Don't mention omentoplasty, etc. All nothing will come. If your patient is TAVO, less than 40, small vessel disease, he has got an ulcer. You tried all those lifestyle modification, everything, whatever you have written, including Berger's heel. Then you mention lumbar sympathectomy. Never mention as a first, only after you give all the things, whichever I have listed you. Patient still has got pain. Examiner is tempted to ask you, do you know any surgery done for TAVO? Then you say lumbar sympathectomy. It is for healing of the ulcers. How does it heal the ulcer? How does it heal the ulcer?
Sir, it causes vasodilation, so increase the blood supply.
Sympathectomy. Sympathetic tone is obviously lost, gone. Sir. And what is removed in the lumbar sympathectomy?
Sir, L1 to L4 ganglia is
removed. L1? L1 also? Or yes, below the level of L1?
Sir, if it is unilateral, they will remove L1. In bilateral, they...
You don't know, tomorrow you may develop on the other side and somebody may remove that. So don't mention... It is below the level of L1. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Just few questions. How do you identify L2?
It is a prominent ganglion, sir.
There is a ganglion. So you remove below the level of L1, 2, 3 and 4 you remove and identify them in the paravertebral groove. Paravertebral space. Against the transverse process. So that is what you remove below the level of L1. Unilateral, bilateral, your policy is better to remove the level below the level of L1. Effects are temporary. Healing of the ulcer will take place. Patient feels better. But remember, it is now almost hardly anything done. Nobody is doing nowadays. Other indication for lumbar sympathectomy is a term called as coxalgia. It is more in the upper limb, not for the lower limb. So that's where you do cervical sympathectomy. I think let us not worry too much about that. Now, if your patient has got a superficial femoral occlusion, what will you do?
Yes, sir. Superficial femoral occlusion.
That's what is the finding in the Doppler.
Yes, sir. Femoropopliteal bypass I can do.
So you can mention, but today I think you can ask also for an angiogram. Okay. Yes, because sir, you are contemplating surgery. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Are you contemplating surgery? if there is a superficial femoral artery occlusion. Hello?
Sir.
Yes, you have to do surgery. The patient has got superficial femoral artery occlusion.
I do there prefer femoropopliteal bypass.
There are lot, yes, ma'am. There are, see, if it's a big vessel, surgery is going to help, depending on the angiogram, the type of obstruction, the extent of obstruction, the extent of the disease, of the vessel proximal to the affected disease, the vessel distal to the disease. All these things can be found out. And based on that, you can do anything. In either a bypass graft or you can any synthetic graft can be put. Anything can be done. Okay. There are a lot of things. If it's just a thrombus, you can do a thrombectomy. That is what is asking.
So various, to say that TAO, only one surgery, lumbar sympathectomy. If the toe is gangrenous, only remove that gangrenous toe. Don't remove anything else. Because that is what is important. She has used the word conservative, correct word that. Only the toe which is gangrenous, you remove. And lumbar sympathectomy. The common situation I gave you was the superficial femoral artery occlusion. If it is a small segment, even up to 3, even 5 centimeter, there is a consideration of percutaneous angioplasty. Yes, you are written there with or without stenting.
Stenting.
There are some drug eluting stents are available. If the lesion extensive, you can consider for a possibility of a bypass graft. Okay,
yes,
bypass
yes,
graft. So this is the minimum thing expected from a undergraduate point of view. Sir, before we stop, I have few slides to share. Can I share?
Please, sir.
No, the provision is there. Yeah, she should stop sharing now. I will share. Just to.
Tapan.
Or yes, Pallip,
kindly give the.
Is it seen, sir?
Yes, sir.
Just for the students only, I just want to. I will not take because. Yeah, this is the classical dry. Can you see this?
Yes, sir.
You can see typically even the bone is exposed. Look at the edge here, bit edematous, correct? See yes, that? This is actually diabetic. All right. Now look at this. This is all. I don't know whether you can see here color change, but look at this. This is typical diabetic wet gangrene. See that? See the toes? See the foot there? So this is what are the cases. This is dry. This is also dry. How he holds the foot. I said about instep. Instep claudication is basically on the medial side. That's what happens. In your case, probably there was instep claudication. So medial side of the leg there. A young lady of 20 years comes with a 10 toes gangrenous. What is your diagnosis?
Vasculitis.
Very good. This is
very
the fifth
plan
to consider vasculitis syndrome. There are various ones are there. So don't say collagen vascular, just say vasculitis syndrome. There is separate list is there. Please read about that. Yeah, this is what you mean by line of demarcation. Before actually you get a line, you get a zone. This is a dead. This is living. There is some zone of hyperesthesia and zone of granulation. And then it becomes later a line and it slowly deepens up to maybe up to the bone also. It can go there, right? Yeah.
Yes,
that is about the smoking, which all of you know. That is the correct way and that is the wrong way of dorsal aspidus, right? See here, distally palpating is wrong. So this is what I told you. Look at that. How the extensor hallucis longest tendons have been stretched like this so that you get a correct pulse there. And that is how the popliteal artery bending and see the thumb where it is kept there. And this is, of course, the popliteal fossa I mentioned to you. Why you put it in the prone? Because you can see better. And that is the common carotid bifurcation. And you feel it little down. That is for the carotid artery. And that is superficial temporal artery in front of the tragus. Yeah, that's basic anatomy, I think. Yeah, this I brought to show you. That is dorsal aspidus artery, and you can that is the main branch. Going here, you can't feel. Here, you can't feel. It goes into the plantar. So that is how it is metatarsal artery. And these are the branches which ultimately help in the plantar fluid circulation. So that is what is important. Dorsal venous arch and like an arterial arch there. This is what I meant. All of you should know what is meant by handheld Doppler. So that's what is the Doppler effect. Okay. So it's the name of the person. Sometimes they ask you, who is the Doppler? He's the Austrian physicist. So, and that is what you give the velocity. See, superficial femoral popliteal 85. Now look at the velocities of this. Already there is a features of narrowing. That's why you can look at the velocity has come down into the distally when you feel the posterior artery, anterior artery, etc. Now, this is duplex scan. As I already told you about the color. So you can see the vein there. You can see the artery. Keep the transducer. And what is effect is going toward the transducer away. These are the ones you make a diagnosis. Just observe this video for just 2 minutes. Watch what has been called a triphasic signals. What you get in typical patients who has got a atherosclerosis or arterial sclerosis. Can see?
Yes, sir.
I just want to show you the important thing here. Look at the three waves. Have you seen the three waves? Upstroke is systolic, down is diastolic, and there's one more wave. What is that wave due to?
Elastic recoils.
So that is called as a triphasic. And when it will be absent?
In atherosclerosis.
Due to?
Loss of elasticity.
So loss of elasticity or calcification. So if there's a chance for you people to see, you have to go to radiology department and have a look at once the how arterial Doppler is being done. I myself went a few years back for this. Now, that is embolectomy done for an arterial disease. This is the Fugazi catheter. You know, Fugazi is went inside there. Fugazi catheter is put inside. And a patient was a young patient who came with a big emboli sitting in the femoral artery. They have already given a cut in the femoral artery and through which he has put a Fugazi. This is the last part. He has extracted a lot of emboli and followed by, see that is the balloon. And you see now, see the what has been removed. Is it clear? So that is what, this is what is removed from this patient. So it should be done within 6 hours. So it can be done under local. If they ask you what is the treatment, acute embolic, it's almost impending gangrene. He had all those 6 pieces. So under local, make incision there at the bifurcation. It was in the superficial femoral artery. Okay. Yeah, that's all from my side. And
yes, sir. We can. It's almost 8, sir.
Yeah, that's what I said. If there's anything specific, we can take 1 or 2 questions or chat box. They can put.
Tapan, can Kishan? Can we close?
Hello, sir.
This
is Pallavi from
Pallavi
Core Committee.
Yeah.
If there are no more doubts, then we can conclude.
Okay, mate. So doubts, sir. Thank you. Thanks a lot, sir, for sharing.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you all. Good presentation, Tejaswini.
Yeah, Tejaswini, well. All the best to you. Okay.
You did well. You presented well. You answered well. Everything was good. Thank you all. Good night.
Good night.
It was an excellent presentation, Ms. Tejaswini. Thank you for the amazing presentation. And I'd like to thank our mentors, Professor Rajagopal Chennai, sir, and Professor Srinivasan, sir, for the wonderful discussion and their valuable inputs. Thank you so much, sir. And thank you, sir, for sharing all those videos. They were very good.
Yeah, the triphasic flow, sir, is very good, yes, sir.
No, sir, because I believe that if they see once, they will never forget. So
yes, once you see, it is very good.
Yes, okay. Sir. Seeing is learning, as they say.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Everyone, sir, because undergraduates, because of lack of time, they don't go to the duplex room. The patient comes. PGs only take the patient to the. So you are seeing a very good video.
Yes,
thank
sir.
You, sir.
Thank
good
you
night,
so
sir.
Much, sir.
Take care, Pallavi. Take care,
yes,
Tapan.
Bye.
Good night.
Thank you all the attendees for your active participation. Yeah.